Meet Orion, the most advanced AR glasses prototype ever made. Today, Mark introduced Orion to the world at metaconnect 2024, and I was lucky enough to test drive them a few weeks ago. They somehow figured how to fit all of this into this. This is one of those moments that changes everything.
You have arrived to the year 2030.
It feels like magic. Actually, it just feels right. Orion allows you to finally look up, be fully present, and stay connected, controlled by signals that your brain sends to your hand, which Meta's calling gestures. A perfect symbiosis between man and machine, 24/7 access to neural networks and AI. It's like a time machine. Maybe man can finally unlock all the secrets of the universe. And I'm not saying Orion will replace phones. All I'm saying is that where we're going, you won't need one.
Welcome to the future, Mr. Digital.
Phones are not going to be the end of the line, but we're not going to be here in the 2030s communicating and using computing devices that are exactly the same as what we have today. And someone has to build that and invest in it and believe in it. And there's a lot of new technology that needs to get invented to create that.
Yep. Mark saw the future and then he built it.
Interpreted by your brain.
Wait a minute. Are you thinking what I'm thinking? Is Mark a time traveler? Why do I say this? I want you to check this clip from 2016.
Over the next 10 years, the form factor is just going to keep on getting smaller and smaller, and eventually we're going to have what looks like normal looking glasses that can do both virtual and augmented reality.
He's been predicting this for a long time. But then he goes all in on the metaverse, spending $46 billion in the last 3 years, even changing the name of his company to Meta. I mean, who does that? Next thing he does, he spends a fortune on Nvidia, buys 150,000 H100 chips. These are the same chips they use to train AIs. Does this purchase before there's an AI boom? And the other interesting thing is that he partners with Ray-Ban in 2020. And you're gonna see how this all plays out perfectly into where we're going next. But first, let's talk about how Meta makes money. They make money by selling ads. That's basically as simple as it gets. And the only other way to make money in this space is to sell a device, which is why Mark was heavily criticized for the decisions he was making over the last few years. Facebook was losing a lot of money, and none of Mark's decisions really made any sense until one main thing happened. And you guys can probably guess it. The AI boom.
Artificial intelligence.
The first real artificial intelligence.
Look, the arrival of strong artificial intelligence has been inevitable for decades.
Artificial intelligence.
We are talking artificial intelligence.
You see, all those things that he was getting criticized for actually positioned Meta to be in a great position to win the AI race. This guy was playing chess, which leads to one main question. How do you win the AI race? And the answer is actually pretty simple. You have to make AI invisible. Fully integrated into our day-to-day lives where we don't have to spend an ounce of our energy to access to use it. It's just part of us. Invisible. Kind of like Tony Stark using Jarvis.
What does that look like to you, Jarvis?
Whoever gets there first wins the race. Which now explains why Apple partnered up with OpenAI. And if you look at the way they shipped out the iPhone 16, they shipped it out with a non-working AI. They shipped out a product that does not work. Apple never does this. And that's why Orion changes everything.
It's on?
Yep.
Kind of out so you can just...
Yep.
You got me focused?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no, that is nuts. That is crazy. I don't even know how to... Oh, shit. It's with my eyes that I'm looking?
Hands.
Hands, wow. Wow, this is actually insane. And then click to tap to
pinch.
Yeah. Okay, pinch. No, I'm on the browser now. No
pinch
kidding.
Video.
You can see what I'm seeing?
No.
How did you know? I was on YouTube. Oh, yeah. Can I open Stargazer real quick?
All right, let's start off with reimagined experiences. These are new AR experiences designed to help you stay present, connected, and empowered. Everything from taking a virtual call to checking your email or scrolling on Instagram is easily doable on the Orion. I was able to witness the first ever FaceTime call when Roberto successfully dialed his wife.
Hi, Nora. Daddy's calling from the future. I'm wearing these amazing AR glasses that you'll probably use when you...
What's really different from traditional headsets is shared AR experiences that allow you to collaborate and even compete with others. That's Roberto playing ping pong against Suck. I won't reveal who won, but let's just say these two guys have unfinished business. Let's get into the tech here. Let's start off with the breakthrough materials. Orion is stacked with silicone carbide instead of glass lenses, offering a high index of refraction. You can clearly see the eyes of anyone wearing them. They've included advanced waveguides. It has these nanoscale 3D structures that diffract light for a field of view. I believe it's 72 degrees, if I'm not mistaken. Orion's the closest thing to Jarvis. Fully touchless, wireless, and controlled by brain signals that are sent to your hand. The EMG neural wristband has haptic feedback, which allows you to control Orion through simple hand gestures. You'll be able to be like in the cold, having your hands in your hoodie or jacket, and still be able to control Orion. Doesn't need to see your hands, unlike all the other headsets that I've seen out there. It's got everything you need as a creator. It has 20 custom silicone chips, 7 cameras, some being infrared cameras, and a bunch of microscopic sensors, along with mirrored lenses that allows for tracking eye movements. And of course, full access to Meta AI. Something very interesting happened during Roberto's demo. He actually used the AI to generate an image. He saved the file, sent that out to print, and then somebody brought us a print, you know, within a minute. And that's why it works, because you don't have to go and learn something new. You've already done this your entire life. And to add to this, Orion is lightweight, weighing only 98 grams. It's made of magnesium alloy, the same material that they use for Formula One.
The way I see it, if you're gonna build a time machine into a car, why not do it with some style?
Check out how it compares to other headsets and just other glasses in general. Glass have been part of culture for centuries, and I'm willing to put a bet that smart glasses become as culturally relevant as smartphones. Think about it, no wires, no remotes, and light enough to forget you're wearing them. Since the start of the AI wave, so many new things have come into play. The first thing that comes to mind is Mark made a decision to launch his own AI, and he made it open source.
A lot of how we've grown up over the last 10 or 15 years was building our apps through phone platforms that our competitors controlled. So it's somewhat soul crushing to like go build something that you think is gonna be good and then just get told by Apple that you can't ship it because they wanna like put us in a box because they view us as competitive. You know, we're a big enough company now that one of the things that I've resolved is that for the next generation of technology, I want us to build and have more control over the next set of platforms that we're gonna build. So I think AI is a critical one.
Let's play some chess here. And now you can see why those 150,000 H100 chips that he bought years ago, now it kind of makes sense. And it puts him in a position where they're gonna be the leaders of AI within the next 12 months. Now this other huge investment he made into VR and metaverse is also playing out. Think about what the Reality Labs team was able to do. They were able to put this entire VR huge headset into some tiny glasses. This was made possible because of so many different advancements in so many different fields of modern computing.
Augmented and virtual reality is another critical one. It's kind of the way that we can control our own destiny on this and make sure that we have access to leading AI is by building it and having it become an industry standard.
And me personally, I do believe that the final frontier will be VR, but the first adoption will come with AR. And for those that don't know the difference between AR and VR, let me explain because this is very important. AR is simply having one layer in the real world. VR is having a complete headset, you're fully immersed into a virtual world. Kind of like Ready Player One, think about it like that. And the reason I believe this is because VR still takes a lot of energy and effort just to simply put it on. I mean, it kind of feels like you're Darth Vader when you're wearing one of these. And these VR experiences are also really hard to make, really expensive, because there's like an infinite number of possibilities. I mean, basically you have a blank slate and you go out there and create what you want. Now I say all that to say this, when I realized that AR is here, VR is here, and they're kind of coming together, I realized and I had a holy F moment. And this is where I realized the genius of Mark. While everyone is out there busy building this virtual world, Meta flipped things around and said, let's bring the digital world to you. And shouldn't have that come first anyways? Like, when you really think about it, that should have been first. And for this to make more sense, think about how 99% of people actually use their smartphones. You can probably count the number of things they do on that phone with your hand. So emails, text messages, FaceTime calls, video games, social media, take photos, capture memories. We've entered a new era of technology, leaving behind the old traditional ways of interacting with computers and smartphones. They found a way to completely eliminate the need for remotes, keyboards, or even tapping on the screen. This is a breakthrough that changes everything of how we communicate with technology. It's more intuitive and allowing people to be more present in day-to-day lives, minimizing the need to look down and without sacrificing connection. And you can kind of see where this is going now. And I'd like to think about this in four phases. Phase one, which is kind of already happening, that is the adoption of an AI wearable, which is the Ray-Ban Meta glasses. Now you'll start seeing them more and more and more. They'll be like the hottest thing during Christmas, and everybody's gonna have them at school, and it's gonna become part of culture. And the numbers show it. There's over 400 million users already on Meta AI, and there's over 185 million weekly users over all the different apps. You know, talking about Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp, Messenger. It's already part of our day-to-day. And that leads me to the second phase, which is currently happening, which you're seeing in real time. The Orion presents this opportunity for developers to build in the future. They can time travel to the future and build these experiences for us. They're gonna recreate everything you can do on a phone with your glasses. And if all this plays out the way I'm thinking, people will just get to a point where they'll just upgrade to when the Orions come out, because that leads us to phase three. And phase three is actually very simple. Mass adoption of glasses with integration of AI fully immersed into our lives. That's where, like, it starts getting fun. You're just talking to your AI at that point. Neural networks, power of AI, and it just works with you. And it gets to the point where people just feel comfortable using it.
You know, when I was getting started with my company, it's, you know, I needed to know all the stuff about coding in order to be able to build the idea that I had. And in the future, you may not even need to. You might just be able to, like, you know, express what you're trying to build, and an AI system will be able to help you with the code and all of that.
And this leads us to phase four around the year 2033, where VR headsets are actually the size of just regular glasses. At that point, you can just choose between what you want. And that's really how I see it play out. That's how we get to this Ready Player One metaverse eventually over the next 15, 20 years. So I'll leave you guys with this. There's so much irony in the name Orion. Orion was named after the NASA space shuttle Orion, which was designed to take humans to the moon and to Mars and beyond. There's also a constellation named Orion, and both of these you have to look up to be able to see them. Orion allows you to look up and stay present, stay connected with the people that you love most, which for most of us happens to be our parents, our grandparents, our elders, aunts, uncles. And ask yourself, what do these people that I look up to value the most? And the answer is simple. It's time. Orion's a time machine. Until next time, if you made it to the end, I invite you to check out the next episode. We're gonna go a lot deeper. We're just getting started.
Life moves pretty fast. You don't stop and look around once in a while, you could miss it.
And what do you guys think? Is Mark really a time traveler? I mean, he did build a time machine. And today Meta also released Llama 3.2, which are their first vision models. And pretty much what it means is that they can now understand both images and text easier for you to communicate with Meta AI.